Ladies and gentlemen, you're all very welcome to this evening's literary cabaret of marriages of convenience. The novel Como Agua para Chocolate by Laura Esquivel, written in 1989. In English, it was called Like Water for Chocolate. And it's set in Mexico in the revolution, late 1800s, early 1900s. And it's divided into 12 chapters. And every chapter is for 1 month in the year, from January to December. And every chapter starts with a recipe, a Mexican recipe, that has to do with an event that's important to the protagonist, whose name is Tita. At the very start, we hear or we read, if you've seen the adaptation of the movie, and this is a Mexican accent, okay, which is not my natural accent, but I know how to do it because I lived in Mexico as a child for 7 years. So, la cebolla tiene que estar finamente picada. The onion has to be very finely chopped. Le sugiero ponerse un pequeño trozo de cebolla en la mollera, con el fin de evitar el molesto lagrimeo cuando uno lo está cortando. So a little tip for cutting onions is to put an onion here on the top of your head where there's a little dimple to stop you crying. I just wish I'd known that for the last few years.
Lo malo de llorar cuando uno pica cebolla no es el simple hecho de llorar, sino que a veces uno empieza y ya no puede parar.
The bad thing about crying when you're cutting onions is that once you start, you can't stop. I don't know if that's your experience. Tita, the protagonist in this story, cried in the womb when her mother cut onions. And she's born on the kitchen table in a torrent of tears that shoot out of the mother. And that's the beginning of the movie. All over the kitchen table and all over the kitchen floor. And then the sun dries the tears, and all of the salt is swept up, 20 kilograms of salt put into a sack and used in their kitchen for different recipes for the pursuing years. It's a style that uses magical realism. Have those of you who have your camera on, did you ever watch the movie or read the story? You don't have to unmute, you can just, oh, okay, that's interesting. Okay, so Tita experiences love at first sight. And she says, it says in the novel,
cuando Tita sintió sobre sus hombros la ardiente mirada de Pedro, comprendió perfectamente lo que debe sentir la masa de un buñuelo al entrar en contacto con aceite hirviendo.
When Tita first set eyes on Pedro, she knew what the dough or the batter of a donut feels when you put it into boiling oil.
Era tan real la sensación de calor que la invadía que ante el temor de que como a un buñuelo le empezaran a brotar burbujas por todo el cuerpo, el vientre, el corazón, los senos, y bajó la mirada y trató de huir.
She was afraid that like a donut she'd start erupting in puffs of, you know, crispiness, so she averted the eyes, so she wasn't looking at Pedro anymore. So she experiences love at first sight, but she's not allowed to marry because tradition has it that being the youngest daughter, she has to look after her mother until her dying days. So when the boy comes to ask for her hand in marriage, the mother offers the other sister, which perhaps somebody in the audience has personally experienced. Certainly when my grandmother, when my grandfather in Strabane asked for my grandmother's hand in marriage, The parents asked, well, you can, but would you not like this other sister? Because there was a few, you know, so the choice was offered, but he said, no, I want Rose. So a similar situation happens in the play, The House of Bernarda Alba García Lorca, set in the south of Spain. So when I was talking to Vanessa Corujeira, our flamenco dancer, these were the ideas I gave her. The south of Spain and what one might feel when you're not allowed to marry the person that you love. So I'll hand you over to Vanessa.
I'm not from this land. I don't know anybody. Whoever does it, may God bless him. For my kids. They say about me, I'm running out of time. They say about me, if I'm dead or alive. And I say, as long as my heart keeps beating, I'll defeat my enemy.
Thank you. calzoncillo y el rayo es el mismo.
Just gonna do a bit of footwork now. Escobillas, proseguirillas también, okay? Okay, thank you.
Now you know what we do in Spain when you marry us to somebody that we didn't want to be married to. We do that every day in the living room and in the kitchen. So something that has always intrigued me about marriages of convenience or arranged marriages. We had a friend in Mexico who, let's say, in the 40s, she went to Mexico, like on a 3-week boat, I suppose, to marry somebody that she had known in Spain when she was little, but she hadn't seen him in 15 years. So they married by proxy, and she went on the boat to meet him and marry him. And they were very close friends of the family. And by what I can see, they seemed very happy. She's certainly been a matriarch of a big family. And all I can hope for is that the first encounter, the first few days were, I'm interested in how love, where there isn't love, can appear. You know, we think we have to be in love to want to be with somebody for the rest of our life, but maybe if we're put with somebody for the rest of our lives, we do something about it and we start to love each other. So I don't know if any of you read the novel The Painted Veil, written in 1925 by Somerset Maugham, and it has had 3 film adaptations, one in 1934 with Greta Garbo, another in 1957, and most recently in 2006.
What do you want?
I brought you your supper.
All right, just leave it there.
What's that you're doing?
I'm testing the nitrate levels of a local tomato.
Why? Why?
It can't possibly interest you.
Well, enjoy your supper. Won't you listen to what I have to say?
All right, if you insist.
It was just today, having been at the convent with those nuns.
What have they done? Converted you?
No. They spoke of you. And it made me feel that...
What? Made you feel what?
I think I've been afraid of you.
Well, you should have been. Now, if you'll excuse me, if I can't work, I'm going to bed.
If we could just talk about...
Honestly, I don't understand you, okay? What is it that you want from me?
Perhaps I want us to be a little less unhappy.
Well, you're mistaken in thinking that I am. I am far too busy to think of you very much.
That's exactly it. I feel useless.
What do you propose I do about it?
For God's sake, will you stop punishing me? Do you absolutely despise me?
No. I despise myself.
Why?
For allowing myself to love you once. Or maybe I'm just too proud to fight.
I don't know about that.
My heart. In the afternoon, we journeyed slowly back to the old town. I told Kate about a time at the end of the summer at 19 when an Australian had taken me on the back of his motorbike off to a remote country place. I remembered him standing on the side of the road and saying that only a few hundred miles away there was a terrible, terrible war raging in Croatia. We thought of the horrors of Sarajevo as we stood in the dusty hot road in exquisite evening light bathing the lavender. He offered to take me on a road trip for a few months to see the surrounding countries. Did you consider going? Kate asked. I paused. Life for a minute had opened a vast doorway, something adult and scary and strange. I said, I didn't love him. He was nice, but unrealistically, I had to go back to college, parents. And I had gone back, and the world of Dublin shut its doors around me tight again, and I had forgotten all this. Now Kate and I looked around us. La Balbala was gone, of course. It had only been a summer business and they had gone swiftly bust. But the streets, the doorways, these were where it had all been. The memories, the smells, the din. The night Philippe had called to my window in the middle of a raging storm after months of 40 degrees heat. Rose, Rose, he had called up to me, drenched wet, his eyes on fire. It rains, Rose, it rains. Kate and I went back down towards the bay and found an Italian on a little street. A grey-haired man sitting at his easel smiled out at us through the window. Bonjour, madame, he beckoned us in. Bonjour, we shyly entered. Inside, all his paintings were of women, confident, unique women, going about their businesses on sunny French streets with lots of style. And the one on his easel was of another such woman, blonde and a little soft. He told us he was a Belgian accountant, that he had retired here after raising his family to this atelier with his practical financial flair, obviously serving him with a tidy setup of the shop. To me, he was Pinocchio's father, like I remembered him in the Ladybird books, breathing life into his wooden boy, his son. And this man was making his paintings come alive. He loved his job, he told us, because it gave him the opportunity to meet beautiful women like us. We blushed beneath our freckles. I walked away feeling like I had walked into the manifestations of all my dreams, peace, the brushes, the oils, a haven of the infinite in the middle of life's crazy wars. Down the winding of another road, Kate bought a wooden handmade candle holder of an owl. OWL, she said, means one with life. She wanted me to have it and keep it.
the person in motion. I was your wife, it never occurred to want more. You were my sky, my star, and my moon, and my ocean. We can never go back to before. We can never go back to before.
We alone can't light our own matches. We need the help of oxygen and a flame, just like a real match does. But the oxygen in our case must come from the breath of a loved one, and the candle flame can be a melody, a word, a caress, something that pulls the trigger. And we all have to learn what pulls our trigger, because it is the explosive flare of the combustion of a match that feeds our souls. If there's nothing to trigger that explosion, our box of matches becomes damp, and then we'll never be able to light any of them. But there are many ways to put a damp matchbox to dry. That's the good news. It's important to light the matches just one at a time, because an intense burst of emotion, if an intense burst of emotion were to ignite them all at once, they would produce such a strong brilliance that before our eyes a tunnel would appear of such radiance, showing us the path we forgot at birth, the same path that calls us back to our divine origin.
I'm going to play a song called Villages of Ether. And this is from a collaboration I did with a very good friend of mine, Justin Grands. So a sort of a marriage of convenience, in that it was a collaboration. And the song is called, yeah, Villages of Ether. And I took the title from a poem by Emily Dickinson, a poet I love. And I think it started off saying, she visits villages of ether. And at the time I was working on a collaboration with Justin called Idiot Songs, which was based on Dostoevsky's The Idiot. Which is a book about a really lovely, innocent and brave character who kind of speaks to all the hypocrisy of society in St. Petersburg. She visits villages of ether by a sea of shadows, a nomad with no bed beneath her, swallowing the snow and swallowed by a sea of ether. I can scarce make out her form. Lone enzyme in a universe of ether, set on the way of harm. When she comes back, she'll be strong. She will be wise, wiser than Solomon on her return. Thank you. she swam across are vanished now. Our afterthoughts, the vacant, the somber skies vanished with the lullabies she sang. With a full heart, slip behind the moon after dark, the friends from her colored past she keeps in a black and white photograph. So come in from the dark, dear darling. It's hard to see in the dusk, in the gloaming, but there's light, and it's in that white orb looming. Come in from your ethereal roaming. Ethereal roaming. Thank you.
Well done, Pearse. Thank you.
Woo! So much.
Wow, unmute yourself, ladies and gentlemen. Make noise for Pearse.
Woo! Woo!
Hey!
Woo! Thank you, Pearse. Are you?
Hi. Hi. Could I get the same?
How's Billy?
Oh, he's great. Except he had a... He fell and cut his face. He has a scar, Joanna, from here to here. I mean, I feel like it's my fault somehow. Like I could have done something, like stopped it.
You can't tell from a distance, Ted.
What?
I've seen him.
You have?
A few times. Sometimes I sit in the cafe across the street when you watch when you take him to school. I've been in New York for the past 2 months. That's the reason why I wanted to talk to you today, because the last time you saw me, I was
he's a
pretty
little
bad
shaky.
Yeah, I was.
Well, you look lovely now.
Oh.
What?
I have a whole speech.
Oh, go ahead.
I don't know. All my life I've felt like someone's wife or someone's mother, someone's daughter. I mean, even the whole time we were together, I never knew who I was. So that's why I had to go away. I went to California. Because that seemed like it was the farthest away I could get. And in California, I think I found myself. I got myself a job. I got myself a therapist, a really good one. And I feel better about myself than I ever have done before. And I've learned a great deal about myself.
Such as? No, I really like to hear what you've learned.
Well, I've learned that I love my little boy and that I'm capable of taking care of him.
What do you mean?
I want my son.
Well, you can't have him.
You don't need to get defensive. Don't try to bully me, okay?
I'm not getting defensive. I mean, who walked out of our home 15 months ago?
I don't care.
I'm joking.
I'm still his mother.
Yeah, from 3,000 miles away. Just because you write a few postcards doesn't mean you have the right to come in here.
Stopped loving him. I never stopped wanting him.
How can you be so sure that he wants you?
How can you be so sure that he doesn't want me?
Look, we'll just sit here and bat this back and forth. It's just like it was for 8 years. I mean, this is just like old times.
You can't deny me access to my own baby.
Don't tell me what I can and cannot do. Don't talk to me that way.
I've anticipated this.
Look, I don't want to get into this. Look, you just do what you have to do, and I'm going to do what I'm going to have to do.
I'm very sorry about this because
you
I
just do what you have to do.
For generations and generations, people, human beings, have been betrothed at the age of 3 years old to somebody who they were going to marry in the future. Oscar Wilde married a woman called Constance Lloyd in 1884 because his reputation about his sexuality was becoming a scandal, and he needed to hush those rumors, and he also needed money. So there are many reasons to marry for convenience. Shakespeare has a play called All's Well That Ends Well, which many of you will have probably seen, and the plot is just ridiculously hilarious to suggest that all's well that ends well, when in fact it's a man that doesn't want to marry a woman, and he says, well, they get married because they have to. But he tells her very clearly, we will never be married unless you wear this ring and you become pregnant with my son, which I'm not going to collaborate with. I'm not going to cooperate. So she manages to disguise herself as somebody else that he likes. And in the dark, she's in the bed instead of this other woman. So the ring is given to her. And also she becomes pregnant on that single moment of conception. And at the end of the play, they explain the facts to him. She says, look, I have the ring and I'm pregnant. And he says, woohoo, all is well that ends well. So, ladies.
Pretending that we'll meet each time I turn a corner, I walk a little faster. Pretending life is love's around the corner, I walk a little faster. I can't begin to see my future shine as yet. No sign as yet. You're mine as yet. Rushing to a face I can't define as yet. Keep bumping into walls and making lots of fall. Even though I'm each and every corner with nothing but disaster, I set my chair a little higher, I hope a little longer, build a little stronger, castle in the air, and think we'll be there. I walk a little faster. Shine as yet, no sign as yet, you're mine. Rushing to a face that I can't define as yet, keep bumping into walls and taking lots of falls, and even though I'm round each and every corner with nothing but disaster, I set my chin a little higher, hope a little longer, build a little stronger castle in the air.